गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू. नाउ वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट द नेक्स्ट चैप्टर दैट इज फर्स्ट ऑर्डर लॉजिक. सो वील सी ऑल द कॉन्सेप्ट्स वन बाय वन. नंबर फर्स्ट दैट्स रिप्रेजेंटेशन रिविजिटेड. नाउ हियर वी हैव टू रिविजिट वट एवर द प्रेजेंटेशन और वट एवर द लॉजिक वी आर गोइंग टू अप्लाई. सो इन दिस सेक्शन वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस द नेचर ऑफ रिप्रेजेंटेशन लैंग्वेजेस, द प्रोग्रामिंग लैंग्वेज, स्टेटमेंट, वर्ल्ड, टू बाय टू. PIT is a fairly natural way to assert that there is a PIT in the square 2 by 2. So here we are going to use a kind of language where we are going to represent the logic. So the natural language representation languages, the nature of representation languages, the programming language, statement, world, 2 by 2 tends to PIT. That means the PIT in the square 2 by 2. Such a representation might be considered as ad hoc, that is temporary. Database systems were developed precisely to provide a more general, domain-independent way to store. This procedural approach can be contrasted with the declarative nature of proportional logic, in which knowledge and inference are separate and inference is entirely domain-independent. The proportional logic is a declarative language because its semantics is based on the truth relation between sentences and possible words. It also has a sufficient expressive power to deal with partial information using disjunction and negation. Propositional logic has a third property that is desirable in representation language, namely compositionality. Here we are going to discuss how we are going to represent the logic in a natural or natural language sentences in a representative way. So one can be in a declaration way or a declarative way where the proportional logic, that is AND or negation, so these can be applied, or it can be composite by using a third party negotiation, so like this. Next, the sub point is the language of thought. Language also seems to influence through seemingly arbitrary grammatical features such as gender of nouns. For example, bridge is a masculine in Spanish and feminine in German. So Spanish speakers choose big, dangerous, strong, towering, whereas German speakers choose beautiful, elegant, fragile, slender. So there can be different kind of language thoughts for in different domains or in different countries. So the words can serve an anchor point that affect how we perceive the world. In the first order logic reasoning system that use CNF, we can see that the linguistic form, that is negation of A, disjunction V, B, and negation of A, disjunction, negation of B. So here is the conjunction, here is the disjunction, are same because we can look inside the system and see that the two sentences are stored in the same canonical CNF form. Here we have taken one example of the first order logic. So if I write a logic like this, it is same as like this also, because after opening the bracket, negation of A, union B, okay, it is same as like this. Now can we do that with the human brain? Until recently the answer was no, but now it may be by using AI. So the one scientist, that is Michael et al., put subjects in an fMRI, that is functional magnetic resonance imaging machine, showed that the words such as celery and imaged their brains. The researchers were then able to train a computer program to predict from a brain image what word the subject has been presented with. Given two choices, that is celery and or airplane, system predicts correctly 70% of the time. The system can even predict at above chance level for words it has been never seen an fMRI image of before, and for the people it has never seen before. So this was about basic language representations. Next point is combining the best of formal and natural languages. So we are going to combine the best things from the natural language and best things from the formal language. When you look at the syntax of the natural language, the most obvious elements are nouns and noun phrases that refer to the object. For example, squares, pits, rampuses, and the verbs and verb phrases that refer to the relations among objects. Is breezy is adjacent to shoot. Some of these relations are functions, that is relations in which there is only one value for a given input. It is easy to start listing examples of the object and relations and functions. Now what mean by object then? The people, houses, numbers, etc. These can be the objects. Now the relations, there can be inner relation or a property such as red, round, bogus, prime. So these are can be relations. So the words which are going to represent some kind of relations, maybe a binary relation or a unary relation, that can be represented. Now the functions: father of, best friend, third inning of, one more than. So these kind of functions. So these are some kind of examples where we are going to combine formal and the natural language. Now we'll see one example more. 1 + 2 = 3. So this is natural language representation. Now the object 1, 2, 3, 1 + 2. These are the objects. Now relation is equals, function is plus. So 1 + 2 is the name for the object that is obtained by applying the function plus to the object 1 and 2, and 3 is the other name for the object. Squares numbering, squares neighboring the vampus are smelly. Objects here are the objects are vampus, squares, these are the objects. Properties are smelly and the relation is neighboring. So like this we can find out the relation, how there is a relation between a natural language. In the relation there can be object, there can be relation. And next example we'll see, that's evil king John ruled England in 12,000. Here also we can differentiate what are the object and what is the relation and what are the properties. Now the first order logic can also be expressed fact about some or all of the objects in the universe. This enables one to represent the general laws or rules, such as statement squaring neighboring the vampus are smelly. The primary difference between the proportional and the first order logic lies in the ontological commitment made by each language, that is what it assumes about the nature of reality. Mathematically, this statement is expressed through the nature of the formal models with respect to which the truth of sentences is defined. For example, the proportional logic assumes that there are facts that either hold or do not hold in the world. Each fact can be in one of the two states, true or false. So in the case of proportional logic, there can be conjunction, disjunction, negation like this. And in case of first order logic, there can be logical statements or there can be proportional statements, or there can be natural language statements, from where we can differentiate the objects, we can differentiate the properties, we can make the relations between them. So like this we can make the representation. Second point is, the first order logic assumes more, namely that the world consists of the object with certain relations among them that do or do not hold. Next is the higher order logic. Now the higher order logic views the relation and the functions referred to by the first order logic as object in themselves. This allows one to make assertions about all relations. For example, one could wish to define what it means for a relation to be transitive. Unlike most special purpose logics, higher order logic is strictly more expressive than the first order logic, in the sense that some sentences of the higher order logic cannot be expressed by any finite number of first order logic sentences. Now, a logic can also be characterized by its epistemological commitment, the possible state of the knowledge that it allows with respect to each fact. In both propositional and the first-order logic, the sentence represents a fact and the agent either believes the sentence to be true, believes it to be false, or has no option. So that is same as a fuzzy logic also. These logics therefore have a three possible states of knowledge regarding any sentence. Systems using probability 3. Now here is the representation of the languages. Now if it is a propositional logic, then ontological commitment will be, ontological commitment means what exists in the world. An epistemological commitment means what an agent believes about the fact. Now first we talk about the propositional logic. In case of propositional logic, we are considering the facts. The fact may be true or false, or the fact may be unknown. Next, that's first order logic. When we apply first order logic, it includes the facts, it includes the object, and includes the relations between fact and object also, or between the different kind of object also. So that relation or that fact or that object can be true or a false, or there may not be any relation, or the object may be unknown. Next, that is temporal logic. It includes facts, object, relations, and times. It may be true, false, or unknown. Next, that is probability theory. Probability theory includes fact, and it is going to give the degree of belief belongs to 0 or 1. So it can be 0 or 1. Next, that is fuzzy logic. Facts with the degree of truth belongs to 0, 1, and epistemological commitment will be unknown interval values. Now the formal languages and their ontological and epistemological commitment. So this is the diagram. It is going to represent the different kind of languages we are going to use in the AI and what it depends. The ontological commitment will be what, and the epistemological commitment will be what. So this was a basic scenario for this. Next is the syntax and semantics of the first order logic. How we are going to write the syntax. Now the model for the first order logic. Now the figure shows the model with five objects: Richard the Lionheart, King of England, from 1189 to 1199. His younger brother, the able King John, who ruled from 1999 to 1215. The left legs of Richard and John and the crown. Now the object in the model may be related to various ways. In the figure, Richard and John are the brothers. Formally speaking, they have the relations. So obviously they are in the relation. And this relation is just a tuple with a set of tuples, the objects, and they are related. So the brotherhood relation in this model is to set Richard and Lionheart, King John, Richard the Lionheart. The crown is on the King's John head, so the on head relation contains just one tuple, the crown, the King John. The brother and the on head relation are the binary relations, that is, they relate pairs of objects. The model also contains unary relation or properties. The person property is true of both Richard and the John. The King property is true only of John, and the crown property is true only of the crown. So this kind of one kind of explanation of the relation. So here we are going to represent the relation based on the explanation in the above this point. Now whatever the relation we are going to represent in case of in terms of the tuples, that tuples are described over here. Now here is the model containing the five objects, two binary relations, three unary relations. So here is the person, this is the R and this is J. So how we are going to relate, or how the it is going to relate. So this was kind of explanation. Certain kinds of relationship are the best considered as functions in that a given object must relate to exactly one object in this way. For example, each person has one left leg, So the model has a unary left leg function that includes the following mapping. Richard the Lionheart belongs to Richard left leg. King John belongs to John's left leg. So this kind of relations we are going to describe it. Next point is symbols and interpretation. What are symbols we are going to use to represent a language, and how or what are the interpretation of these, we are going to describe it. The basic syntactic element of the first order logic are the symbols that stand for object, relations and the functions. The symbols therefore come in three kinds. The constant symbols, which stands for the object. Predicate symbols, which stands for relations. And function symbol, which stand for the functions. We adopt the convention that these symbols will begin with uppercase letters. For example, we might use the constant symbols Richard and John, the predicate symbol brother, unhaired person, king and crown, and the function symbol left leg. As in proportional logic, every model must provide the information required to determine if any given sentence is true or false. Thus, in addition to its object, relations and functions, each model includes an interpretation that specifies exactly which object, relations and functions are referred to by the constant, predicate and function symbols. One possible interpretation for our example, which is a logician would call the intended interpretation, is as follows. Richard referred to Richard the Lionheart and John referred to the King Evil John. So here are two references. One, that's a Richard. Richard is going to refer as a Lionheart and John is going to refer as the Evil King John. Now the brother refers to the brotherhood relation, that is the set of tuples of object given in equation 8.1. On the head refers to the on head relation that holds between the crown and King John. Person, king and the crown refer to the set of objects that are person, king and crown. Left leg refers to the left leg function, that is the mapping given in equation 8.2. There are many other possible interpretations. Of course, for example, one interpretation maps Richard to the crown and John to the King John's left leg. There are 5 objects in the model, so there are 25 possible interpretations just for the constant symbols Richard and John. Now we can take into consideration that all the objects need to have the name. But at least we require the name. So the intended interpretation does not name the crown of the leg or the leg. It is also possible for the object to have several names. There is an interpretation under which both Richard and John refer to the crown. If you find this possibility confusing, remember that in proportional logic, it is perfectly possible to have the model in which the cloudy and sunny are both true. It is the job of the knowledge base to the rule out models that are inconsistent with our knowledge. Now here is the representation of entire thing. Sentence can be atomic sentence or a complex sentence. Now the atomic sentence means a simple kind of sentence which can be easily understood, and the complex sentence means it which have another meaning in, or the sentence which makes a confusion, or a sentence which have a depth meaning. It means the complex sentence have 2 or 3 meanings, or one complex sentence may have 2 or 3 atomic sentences also. Now atomic sentences predicate the terms, so here term means term. Now the complex sentences, it contains more than one sentences, or negation of sentences, conjunction of sentences. So like this, here the complex sentences can be have a more than one atomic sentence, it can be multiple sentences like this. Now in the term, we can define the functions, we can define the constants or the variables, and these are the qualifiers, these are the constant, these are the variables. So here we are going to represent the symbols. If I want to represent any qualifier, I can use any one of the symbols. If I want to use any constant, I can use any one of these symbols. So like this, or the operator precedence will be like this. So here is the syntax of the first order logic with equality specified in a Backers node form. Again, this is the diagram for some members of the set of all the models of for a language with two constant symbols R and J and one binary relation symbol. The interpretation of each constant symbol is shown by a gray arrow. So here will be the interpretation. Within each model, the related objects are connected by arrows. Now we are going to talk about the terms. A term is a logical expression that refers to an object. So the term is nothing but it is an object also. The constant symbols are therefore terms, but it is not always convenient to have a distinct symbols to name every object. For example, in English, we might use the expression King John's left leg rather than the giving name to his leg. This is what the function symbols are for. Instead of using a constant symbol, we use left leg John. So here we are going to represent the term. So the left leg of the John, so I can represent like this. In the general case, a complex term is formed by a function symbol followed by a parenthesized list of terms as an argument to the function symbol. It is important to remember that a complex term is just a complicated kind of a name. It is not a subroutine call that returns a value. There is no left leg subroutine that takes a person as an input and return a leg. So there will not be any subroutine, or there will not be any function for the left leg John. We can reason about left leg without ever providing a definition of a left leg. Now consider a term f of t1 up to tn. The function symbol f refers to some function in the model, call it f. The argument terms refer to objects in the domain, call them d1 up to dn, and the term as a whole refers to the object, that is the value of the function f applied to d1 up to dn. Next point is atomic sentences. An atomic sentence is formed from a predicate symbol, optionally followed by a parenthesized list of terms such as brother, Richard, John. This states under the intended interpretation given earlier that Richard the Lionheart is the brother of King John. Now, atomic sentences can have the complex terms as argument. Thus, married, father Richard, mother John. So this is also a sentence, but with a complex kind of terms. State that, now how this is represented. Richard the lion's heart's father is married to the King John's mother. So this meaningful sentence can be written like this also. An atomic sentence is true in a given model if the relation refers to by the predicate symbol holds among the object referred to by the argument. Now we talk about the complex sentences. We can use the logical connectives to construct a more complex sentence with a same syntax and semantics as in proportional calculus. Here are the four sentences that are true in the model of figure 8.2. Under our intended interpretation, negation of brother left leg Richard John, brother of Richard and John, disjunction, brother of John and Richard. So here you can represent it. Next we talk about the quantifiers. Once we have a logic that allows object, it is only a natural to want to express properties of entire collection of objects instead of enumerating the object by the name quantifiers. The first order logic contains two standard quantifiers called universal and existential. Universal qualifiers, so this symbol represents the universal qualification. Rules such as squares neighboring the vampires are smelly, and all kings are persons are the bread and butter of the first order logic. The second rule, all kings are persons, is written in the first order logic as below. So this is the qualifier, x king of x belongs to person x. So this is the qualification. Qualification is usually pronounced for all, so this symbol is represented or pronounced for all. So for all x, kings of x belongs to person x. So the sentence is, for all, if x is a king, then x is a person or x belongs to person. The symbol x is called a variable. By convention, the variables are lowercase letters. A variable is a term all by itself and as such can also serve as the argument of a function. For example, left leg of x. The term with no variable is called a ground term. The sentence, for all x p, where p is any logical expression, say that p is true for every object x. More precisely, for all x p is true in a given model, if p is true in all possible extended interpretations constructed from the interpretation given in the model, where each extended interpretation specifies the domain element to which x refers. This sounds complicated, but it is really just a careful way of stating the intuitive meaning of universal qualification. We can extend the interpretation in the five ways. X belongs to Richard the Lionheart, X belongs to John King, X belongs to Richard's left leg, X belongs to John's left leg, X the crown. The universally qualified sentence, that is, for all x, king of x, implies person of x, is true in the original mode if the sentence king of x implies person x is true under each of the five extended interpretations. That is, universally qualified sentence is equivalent to asserting the following five sentences. Richard the Lionheart is a king. Richard the Lionheart is a person. King John is a king, implies King John is a person. Richard's left leg is a king, implies Richard's left leg is a person. John's left leg is a king, implies John's left leg is a person. The crown is a king, implies the crown is a person. A common mistake made frequently, even by diligent leaders who have read this paragraph several times, is to use conjunction instead of implication. The sentence, for all x, king of x, disjunction, person x, would be equivalent to asserting Richard the Lionheart is a king, disjunction, Richard Lionheart is a person. King John is a king, implies disjunction, king John is a person. Richard's left leg is a king, disjunction, Richard's left leg is a person. Second is existential qualification. Universal qualification makes statement about every object. Similarly, we can make a statement about some object in the universe without naming it by using existential quantifier. To say, for example, that the King John has a crown on his head, we write existential qualifier x crown of x disjunction on head x John. So existential qualification x is pronounced as there exists an x such that or for some x. So the symbol represents for some x. A common mistake made frequently even by diligent readers who have read this paragraph several times is to use conjunction instead of implication. The sentence, so a sentence like this would be equivalent to asserting Richard the Lionheart is a king, disjunction Richard the Lionheart is a person, King John is a king, disjunction King John is a person, Richard left leg is a king, disjunction Richard's left leg is a person. Now, universal existential qualification. The sentence like this says that P is true for at least one object X. More precisely, this expression is true in a given model if P is true in at least one extended interpretation that assign X to a domain element, that is, at least one of the following is true. Richard the Lionheart is a crown. Disjunction: Richard the Lionheart is on John's head. King John is a crown. Disjunction: King John is on John's head. Richard's left leg is a crown. Disjunction: Richard left leg is on John's head. John's left leg is a crown. Disjunction: John's left leg is on John's head. The crown is a crown. Disjunction: the crown is on John's head. The fifth assertion is true in the model. So the original existentially qualified sentence is true in the model. Notice that by our definition, the sentence would also be true in a model in which King John was wearing two crowns. This is entirely consistent with original sentence, King John has a crown on his head. Just as implies appears to be the natural connective to use with these symbols, the natural connectives to use this symbol. Using disjunction as the main connective with existential qualified lead to an overly strong statement in example of the obvious section. So using implies usually leads to every weak statement indeed. Now consider a statement. Now we consider, suppose, this statement. Then on the surface this might look like a reasonable recondition of our sentence. Applying the semantic, we use that the sentence says that at least one of the following assertion is true. Richard the Lionheart is a crown. Richard the Lionheart is on John's head. King John is a crown. King John is on John's head. Richard's left leg is a crown implies Richard's left leg is on John's head. Now nested quantifiers. We will often want to express more complex sentences using multiple quantifiers. The simplest case is where the quantifier are of the same type. For example, brothers are the siblings can be written as like this. Consecutive qualifiers of the same type can be written as one quantifier with several variables. For example, to say that siblinghood is a symmetry relationship, you can write the equations like this. In other cases, we will have the mixtures. Everybody loves somebody means that for every person, there is someone that person loves. On the other hand, to say there is someone who is loved by everyone, we write like this. The order of qualification is therefore very important. It becomes clearer if we insert parentheses. Everyone has a particular property, namely the property that they love someone. On the other hand, this sentence says that someone in the world has a particular property, namely the property of being loved by everyone. Some confusion can arise when two quantifiers are used with some variable name. Consider a sentence. Here X in brother Richard X is essentially qualified. The rule is that the variable belongs to the innermost quantifier that mentions it. Then it will not be subject to any other quantification. Now another way to think of it is sentences about Richard, not about X. So putting Southside has no effect. It would equally well have been written like this. Because this can be a source of confusion, we will always use different variable names with nested quantifiers. Now, what are the connections between these two symbols, that is nested quantifiers and universal quantifiers? The two quantifiers are actually intimately connected with each other through the negation. Asserting that everyone dislikes partisanship is the same as asserting that there exists someone who likes them, and vice versa. So this will be representation. So I can represent like this or like this. So both are equivalent. We can go one step more. Everyone likes ice cream means that there is no one who does not like ice cream. So I can represent in a mathematical formula like this. Now, this universal qualifier is really a conjunction over the universal universe of the object, and quantifier is a disjunction. It should not be surprising that they obey De Morgan's rule. The De Morgan rule for quantifiers and unquantifier sentence will be as below. So these are the rules for De Morgan's rule. Now, here we do not really need both the universal and quantifiers, just as we do not really need both negation and disjunction. Till readability is more important than parsimony, so we keep both the quantifiers. Next quantifier, that is equality. The first order logic includes one more way to make atomic sentence other than using a predicate and terms as described earlier. We can use the equality symbols to signify that the two terms refer to the same object. For example, father of John is Harry. Say that the object referred to by the father of John and the object referred to by the Henry are the same, because an interpretation fixes the referent of any them. Determining the truth of an equality sentence is simply a matter of seeing that the reference of the two terms are the same object. The equality symbols can be used to state fact about a given function, as we just did for the father symbol. It can also be used with negation to insist that the two terms are not the same object. To say that Richard has at least two brothers, we could write this expression will be like this. The sentence. Now this expression does not have intended meaning. In particular, it is true in the model of figure 8.2, where Richard has only one brother. To see this, consider the extended interpretation in which both x and y are assigned to King John. The addition of negation of x is equal to y rules out such a model. The notation x is equal to y is sometimes used as an abbreviation for negation of x is equal to y. First, we insist that every constant symbol refers to a distinct object, so-called unique names assumption. Second, we assume that atomic sentences are sentences not only to be true, are in fact false, the closed world assumption. Finally, we invoke domain closure, meaning that each model contains no more domain elements than those names by the constant symbols. Under the resulting semantic, which we recall database semantic, to distinguish it from the standard semantic of the first order logic, the sentence equation does indeed state that Richard's two brothers are John and Geoffrey. Database semantic are used in the logic of programming systems. Now, this will be the basic representation. So how it is going to represent a domain or a domain closure assumptions like this. So here with the two objects, there will be four possible two element tuples. So there are 2^4, that is 16 different subsets that tuple that satisfy the relation. So this was about the basic concepts of the qualifiers. So if you have any doubts, any questions, you can put on the comments. Thank you. Now we are going to see first order logic. Now, the first point is assertions and queries in the first order logic. So what will be the statements of the assertion and or what will be the queries in the first order logic? sentences are ordered to a knowledge base using tell, exactly as in proportional logic. So we have seen the tell keyword in the proportional logic of previous chapter. Such sentences are called as assertions. For example, you can assert that John is a king, Richard is a person, and all kings are persons. So tell KB King John, tell KB person Richard, tell KB. So like this, we can ask for questions of the knowledge based using ask. For example, ask KB King John. So these are some kind of examples how we are going to represent a first order logic. Now always these queries are written to questions asked with ask are called as queries or goals. And generally speaking, any goal query that is logically entailed by the knowledge base should be answered affirmatively. For example, given the two preceding assertions, the query ask KB person John should also return true. We can ask quantified queries such as ask KB. This is the answer is true, but this is perhaps not as useful as we would like. If we want to know what the value of x makes the sentence true, we will need a different function ask variables, which we call with ask vars, that is ask variable KB person x, and which yield a stream of answers. In this case, there will be two answers, x or John and x or Richard. Such an answer is called as substitution or a binding list. Ask variable is usually reserved for a knowledge base consisting solely of horn clauses, because in such a knowledge bases, every way of making the query true will bind a variables to a specific values. This is not the case with first order logic. If KB has been told King John in a union King Richard, then there is no binding to X for the query. Second, that's a kinship domain. We have two unary predicates, male and female. Kinship relations, parenthood, brotherhood, marriage, and so on, are represented by binary predicates, parents, siblings, brother, sister, child, daughter, son, spouse, wife, husband, grandparent, grandchild, cousins, aunt, uncle. We use functions for mother and father because every person has exactly one of each of these. We can go through each function and predicate, writing down what we know in terms of other symbols. For example, one's mother is one's female parent. So this will be the equation for that. One's husband is one's male spouse. Again, the equation for the relation. Male and female are disjoint categories. Parent and child are inverse relations. So how we are going to represent implies like this. A grandparent is a parent of one's parent. We can imply like this. A sibling is another child of one's parent. We could go on for several more pages like this, and we can simplify the equations. Each of these sentences can be viewed as an axiom of the kinship domain. Next is number sets and lists. How we are going to represent these in terms of artificial intelligence. Number are perhaps the most vivid example of how a large theory can be built up from a tiny kernel of axioms. We need to predicate net num that will be true of natural numbers. We need one constant symbol 0, and we need one function symbol s, that is successor. The piano exams define a natural numbers and addition. Addition, that is 9 natural numbers, are defined recursively. That is net num of 0. This is the equation for implies. That is 0 is a natural number, and for every object n, if n is a natural number, then s of n is a natural number. So the natural numbers are 0, s of 0, s of 0, and so on. We can represent the numbers. We need axioms to constrain the successor function. So like this, we can define it. Now we can define the additional in terms of successor function. The first of these axioms say that the adding 0 to any natural number m gives M itself. Now notice that the use of the binary function symbol plus in terms of plus M of 0 in ordinary mathematics, the term would be written as M plus 0 using infix notation. The empty set is a constant written as curly brackets. There is one unary predicate set which is true of set. The binary predicates are X implies X belongs to S, X is a member of set S, and S1 is a subset of S2. So set S1 is subset not necessarily proper or a proper set of S2. The binary function R S1 intersection S2, S1 union S2, and X or S, the resulting from adjoining elements X to the set S. One possible set of axioms is as follows. Number one, the only set are empty set and those made by adjoining something to a set. The empty set has no element adjoined into it. In other words, there is no way to decompose the empty bracket into the smaller set of an element. Adjoining an element already in the set has no effect. So we can write equations like this. The only member of a set are the elements that were adjoined into it. We express this recursively saying that X is a member of S if and only if S is equal to some set S2 adjoined with some element Y, where either Y is same as X or X is a member of S2. A set is a subset of another set if and only if all of the first set's members are members of the second set. Two sets are equal if and only if each of a subset of the other. An object is in intersection of the two sets if and only if it is a member of both sets. An object is in the union of two sets if and only if it is a member of either set. Lists are similar to sets. The differences are that lists are ordered and the same element can appear more than once in a list. We can use the vocabulary of list for list. Nil is a constant list with no element. Cons, append, first, reset are the functions, and find is a predicate that does for the list what members does for the set. Second, that's a Wampus world. Already we have seen the game of this. The corresponding first order sentence stored in the knowledge base must include both the percept and the time at which it occurred. Otherwise, the agent will get confused about when it saw what. We use integers for time step. A typical percept sentence would be so like this. Here the percept is a binary predicate and the stench and so on are the constant placed in a list. The actions in the Wampus world can be represented by the logical terms. So turn right, turn left, forward, shoot, grab, climb. These are the some of kind of functions we have to write for the Wampus world. To determine which is the best, the agent program executes the query. Now this function is going to return a binding list such as A or grab. The agent program can then return grab as the action to take. The raw percept data implies certain facts about the current state. For example, we can represent everything like this. These rules exhibit a trivial form of the reasoning process called perception. Notice that the quantification over time t in proportional logic, we would need copies of each sentence for each time step. Simple reflex behavior can also be implemented by quantified implication sentences. For example, given the percept and the rules for preceding paragraph, in this would yield the desired conclusion. Now we have represented the agent's input and output. Now it is time to represent the environment itself. Let's begin with object. Obviously, the candidates are squares, pits, and bumpers. We could name each square, square 1, 2, and so on, but then the fact that square 1, 2, and square 1, 3 are adjoined would have to be an extra fact, and we would need one such fact for each pair of the squares. It is better to use a complex term in which the row and the column appears as integers. For example, we can simply list out the terms like this. So adjacency of any two row squares can be defined as like this. We could name each pair, but this would be inappropriate for a different reason. There is no reason to distinguish among pairs. It is simpler to use a unary predicate pair that is true of squares containing pairs. Finally, since there is exactly one vampus, a constant vampus is just as good as a unary predicate. The agent's location changes over time, so we write at agent S and T to mean that the agent is at the square S at time T. We can fix the vampus location with the equation like this. You can then say that the object can only be at one location at a time. Now the next point we will see, that is knowledge engineering in the first order logic. Knowledge-based engineering process. Knowledge engineering process vary widely in content, scope and difficulty, but all such projects include the following steps. First, that is identify the task. Second, that is assemble the relevant knowledge. Third, decide an vocabulary of predicates, function and constant. Fourth, encode general knowledge about the domain. Fifth, encode a description of the specific problem instance. Sixth, pose queries to the inference procedure and get answers. Seventh, debug the knowledge base. A considerable debugging process could ensue, missing axioms or exams that are too weak can be easily identified by noticing places where the chain of reasoning stops unexpectedly. For example, if the knowledge base includes a diagnostic rule for finding the vampus, the equation will be like this. Instead of biconditional, then the agent will never be able to prove the absence of vampuses. Incorrect axioms can be identified because they are false statements about the world. For example, the sentence like this is false for reptiles, amphibians, and more importantly, tables. The falsehood of this sentence can be determined independently of the rest of the knowledge base. Now, a typical error in the program looks like this. Offset is equal to position plus 1. It is impossible to tell whether this statement is correct without looking at the rest of the program to see whether, for example, offset is used to refer to the current position or to one beyond the current position, whether the value of position is changed by another statement, and so offset could also be changed again. So this was the end of the session. If you have any doubts, any questions, you can put on the comments. Thank you.